Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Will Everidge, and tonight we're going to be going over week two of our 9-week ham radio training. So tonight, week two, we're going over chapter three. If you remember, week one, we covered chapters one and two. And the reason why we're going this route is initially when we did our first week one, I didn't like the outcome. I didn't think it was good enough. So we started back over, and this is also going to afford us an opportunity to finish on week eight. So week nine, week nine is going to be, we're going to go back over the previous 8 weeks of all the chapters, answer questions, and make sure that everybody's ready to sit for their exam. Before we get started, anyone have any questions before we take on chapter three? That's fantastic. Okay, so chapter three, electricity, components, and circuits. Gang, I'm going to tell you, take notes, pay attention. You're going to have more homework. Chapter three for me was I had no background in mathematics or circuitry. So if you have a background in any of these, it'll make it a lot easier. But for me, chapter two and chapter three was a pain in my butt. But today we're going to go over fundamental concepts of electricity and circuits, voltage and current, resistance, capacitance and inductance, reactance, impedance, and resonance. So I know all of that. If you have never done this before, those are probably Greek to you. But we're going to go over the definition of all of them. So you'll have an idea of what they are as we go through, and we can stop and talk about them if you have questions. So again, the nice thing about this format is if you have questions, just chime in, interrupt me, say, hey, Will, I didn't understand that. Please go over it again. And Jim will be happy to do that for you. Thanks, Jim. Okay, so
if I know the answer.
Right, if Jim knows the answer. If Jim doesn't know the answer, then we'll get Larry on the phone, and if Larry doesn't know the answer, then we'll call God, because we're kind of doing this in his house, and obviously he has the answer. So so here we go. Electricity. Although radios use sophisticated electronics, they are based on fundamental principles of electricity. Electricity is really huge in this, guys. It has to do with everything radio. In this chapter, you'll learn about the basic electrical concepts and apply to everything from the household wall socket to the last radio or computer. If you would like some assistance with the math in this chapter, there are some tutorials, and we talked about this after class last week. If you want to go online and purchase the ARRL training manual, you can go and do that. There's also some other ARRL websites that you can go and actually take practice exams, and we strongly encourage that you do this. So the first thing we're going to talk about is voltage and current, or electric current. Represented in equations by the symbol I. So when you see the letter I, the thing that pops in your head should be electrical current, okay, or just current. So I, current, is the flow of electrons. Electrons are negatively charged atomic particles. They're just really small particles with a negative charge. That's it. That's all electrons are. Very tiny particles, and they have a negative charge. That's what you want to remember. Current is measured in units of amperes, which is abbreviated as A or amps. Current is always measured as the flow through something such as a wire or electronic component. An ammeter is used to measure current. So voltage and current. When you think about this, think of current as if you think of it as a water hose, current is going to be the water. Okay, that's the electrical current. And then we'll talk about the pressure here in a second. Electrons are so small that, and here's these numbers, you're going to want to keep track of these. Okay, so electrons are so small that a household 100 watt bulb with a current of 1 amp, it takes 6.25 billion amps to pass through the bulb each second. That quantity is 6.25 billion. Is that right? So 6.25 billion amps. Or if we look at, does everybody remember their math from last week? So how, what's another way that we can say 6.25 billion amps? What's a billion? Is that mega? Is that mega, giga, tera?
Gig. Gig.
A gig. So what's an easier way to say 6.25 billion amps? What else can we say? 6.25 gigaamp? Right? Can we say that?
Sure.
Okay. So that's just an easier way to kind of break things down. But if you look at the mathematical equation, the 6.25 times 1,018 electrons make up one column. Is that how you pronounce that? Column? Is it Coulomb? Okay, so a Coulomb, you're gonna want to know that. It's, and I'm pretty sure that's on the test. So make sure you write that down. So 1 ampere is the flow of 1 column or Coulomb. Is it Coulomb? Coulomb. Okay. So 1,000 electron makes up 1 coulomb of electric charge. 1 ampere is the flow of 1 coulomb of electrons per second. If you need to learn more numbers, written scientific notation, such as the 6.25 times 1,018, refer to the tutorial on the ham radio license manual webpage. Okay, let's move on to voltage. First of all, let's make sure that everybody understands this. Everyone has a pretty good idea of what current is, right? Anybody have any questions about current as represented by the letter I? Everybody knows what a coulomb is, what the number that you're going to need to know, the 6.25 billion. Everybody's good with that. Because all of this is going to come back and it's going to build on everything else. So just like you need to know the metrics for this particular reason, you're going to need to know the 6.25 billion as we move forward. So moving on to voltage. Voltage represented in equations by the symbol E, or the lowercase e, is the electromagnetic force of electric potential that makes electrons move. So if we use the water hose analogy, the current is the water. The force or the pressure that makes the water move is the voltage. Okay, so electrons is the water. What pushes that those electrons with force, okay, is the voltage. Everybody get that? Is that a good analogy? Because I use it later on in the book. I want to make sure everybody gets that. Okay, so voltage is measured in units of volts, which is abbreviated as V. Sometimes V, or lowercase v, is used in equations as a symbol for voltage as well. So if you see the letter E or you see the letter V, it's going to be the same thing. It's going to be voltage. And in fact, we're going to look at some equations later on where they use E instead of V, which I don't know why they would do that. It just doesn't make any sense unless you think of it as electronic or electric potential. So however you want to remember it, just make sure you remember it because it's important. So voltage is measured in voltage is measure of units in volts, which is abbreviated by V, lowercase v. Voltage is always measured from one point to another or with respect to some reference voltage. Voltage is measured with a voltmeter. The polarity of voltage can be either positive or negative. A negative voltage repels electrons and a positive voltage attracts them. So the Earth's surface acts as a universal reference for voltage measurements and is called Earth ground. Ground potential, or just ground. Electrical pressure and flow, figure 3.1, shows a time-tested analogy that helps newcomers to electricity, that's me, understand what voltage and current are and how they act. Voltage acts like pressure in a water pipe and current acts like water flow. that's why I used the reference earlier, it's in the book. You can have lots of pressure with no flow. Think of a pipe with the faucet closed. You can't have flow with no pressure, though. There must always be something pushing water molecules and electrons before they'll move. Pressure is always measured between two points in the plumbing or between one point and open air atmospheric pressure. Voltage is the same, an electric I'm sorry. Voltage is the same. An electrical force that pushes electrons to flow from one point to another and is measured between three points. Water flow must go through something, a pipe or a stream. The current must go through something as well, such as a wire. Okay, Kim, you're now officially part of this training. And current must go through the same thing. So you may have noted that while a positive voltage attracts electrons, figure 3.1 shows that current arrow pointing away from the battery, positive terminal. Before the electron was discovered in 1898, scientists assumed that the positive charge moved to create current. They based electrical laws and conventions on that assumption, which turned out to be wrong because an electron is negatively charged. Luckily, the laws of electricity work just as well with negative charge moving backwards as they do positive charge moving forward. I know we kind of covered that pretty briskly. Let me finish this up. Positive charge moving from a positive to a negative voltage, as shown in the figure, is conventional current, the standard of electronics. You'll learn more about the conventional current and its mirror image electronics current when you upgrade to general. So if we pull up this nice little diagram here, on the left you're going to see water moving through a pipe. On the right, you need me to back up a little bit?
No, it's
the picture. Oh, okay, it's not catching up. Okay, so on the left you're going to have water in a pipe. On the right, you're going to have voltage or current in a circuit, voltage and current in a circuit. Voltage acts similarly to pressure and current similarly to flow in a water system. Voltage between two points is what causes the electrons to move between these points. Current is a measure of how many electrons pass through the circuit per second. Everybody good with that? So current is a measure of how many electrons pass through the circuit per second. Okay, so now we're going to talk about some circuits. All right, so part A shows three light bulbs and a battery connected in a series circuit. The same current flows from the battery through all three light bulbs. Part B shows the same bulbs and battery connected in a parallel circuit. The same voltage from the battery is applied across each light bulb. Now, when I studied this before, I had a problem with this, understanding the implications of what it actually meant. Jim, would you mind shedding a little bit of light on in series versus in parallel?
Yeah, basically the top figure where they're in series is you actually will have, if all those light bulbs have the same resistance, which we haven't talked about yet, you'll have a voltage drop across there. So if your battery is, let's say it's a 12-volt battery, you've got three light bulbs, you're going to have 4 volts across each battery. If you measured it on each side of the bulb, you'd have 4 volts on each side. So the voltage drops off. So you don't have all the voltage on all three bulbs. You have one third of the voltage on each bulb. In a parallel circuit, like the bottom one, you have the same voltage across each bulb.
Okay.
So that explains pretty well.
It's how you want to distribute the voltage.
It's how you want to distribute the voltage, and also it's like, remember the old Christmas tree lights?
Yes.
If one burned out, all of them went out?
Yes.
Okay, that's a series circuit.
Okay.
In other words, your current has to flow from one bulb to the next to the next. If there's a break anywhere in there, you don't have any current flow.
I got you.
Your new lights are, Christmas lights are wired in parallel, so if one bulb goes out, the rest of them still burn.
Gotcha.
I think that's probably easier to understand for a lot of people.
Well, it made it easier for me. Thank you very much.
At least us older folks that used to fight those series lights.
Okay. Anybody have a question on this? Series versus parallel wiring?
I think Jim just called me old.
Wow. Not by name, but we know who you are now.
I bet you're not as old as I am, though.
I don't know.
Over 70. I'm not going to say how much.
Oh, no. I'm not that old yet. Okay.
Nope,
but I do remember battling the Christmas tree lights. Yes, I do remember that.
Oh, wow. Well, the first time
having
I said
to check
can,
each and every one.
Okay, so are we ready to go? All right, here we go. We're going to move on to circuits. Here we go, guys and ladies. A circuit is any path through which current can flow. Pretty simple. If two or more devices, such as a light bulb, are connected in a circuit so that the same current must flow through all of them, that is a series circuit. If two or more devices are connected so that the same voltage is present across all of them, that's a parallel circuit, and we like parallel circuits. So no more messing with the light bulbs. This is in the illustration above. Voltmeters are connected in parallel with a component, also termed across a component or circuit to measure voltage. Ammeters are connected in a series with a component or circuit to measure current. Some meters calibrated in amperes are really voltmeters that measure the volt across a smaller resistor and search in series with the current. Be sure to determine which type of meter you have before using it. I'm guessing that could cause damage to the device if you're using the wrong one. Is that right, Jim?
It's known as blowing a meter up.
All right. Well, let's not do that.
Almost all of your meters today use the voltage drop across the resistor, especially your digital meters that we switch the scale on them. What you're doing, you're switching different resistors in and out. So you don't see too many direct measurement amp meters anymore, except possibly for standard household 110 volt stuff. But very few people even have those.
Okay. Awesome. All right, let's talk about short circuits. A short circuit is a direct connection, usually unintentionally, between two points in a circuit. An open circuit is made by breaking a current path in a circuit. Before you go on, study these technician exam questions. All right, now let's take a look at multimeters. The multimeter, the basic electrical test instrument, are simple meters, voltmeters, ammeters, and ohmmeters. It's quite inconvenient to use a separate meter for each parameter. So the multimeter was invented, short for multifunction meter, which I don't know if that'll be on the exam or not.
Let me just point out one thing, which is not directly applicable to this course, but it's very true. You've got digital meters and analog meters.
Okay.
Your analog meters have a needle that swings.
Mm-hmm.
Digital meters, if you're measuring circuits with extremely low voltage and with no current in backup, in other words, almost static electricity, mm-hmm. a digital meter will read it.
Oh.
An analog, and it'll give you a wrong reading.
Oh, okay.
Okay. A good analog meter has a resistor in there that will bleed off that type of charge, so it will read it correctly.
When you say bleed it off, what do you mean? You mean it'll actually take that charge out of the circuit?
Yeah, it'll actually run the charge from one probe to the other probe.
Really?
Where they come out even.
Okay.
And you run into this, it's called a phantom voltage, and your digital meters, most of them don't do that.
Okay.
So for some measurements, analog meters are better, digital meters are a whole lot cheaper, and for 99% of the stuff to work fine. But you can get some squirrely readings if you're working with extremely small stuff.
Gotcha. Okay. So multifunctional meter is the multimeter. It uses a single meter, analog with a moving needle, or digital to measure all three basic electrical values of voltage, current, and resistance. Multimeters are often referred to as VOM or volt ohm meter, or DVM, digital voltmeter. The typical digital multimeter shown in figure 3.3 uses a switch and different sets of input connections to select which parameter and range of the values to measure. The convenience of having all the different functions in a single instrument more than outweighs the extra complexity of learning how to use a multimeter. So you'll find in unexpected ways to interrupt the multimeter's readings too. For example, if you're measuring the resistance of a circuit and the reading starts out low but gradually increases, that indicates the presence of a large value capacitor. And I don't think we really talked much about capacitors, but I believe we'll be covering that here shortly. So the flexibility afforded to the meter also means that it's important to use the meter properly and safely. Trying to measure voltage or connecting the probes to an energized circuit when the meter is set to measure resistance is a common way to damage a multimeter. Okay. So you must always take heed of the meter's voltage rating. Voltages beyond the meter's rating can flash over to other pieces of equipment or to you, creating a serious shock hazard. Ensure that the voltmeter and leads are rated for the use of the voltage to be measured. These simple and inexpensive instruments should be part of your every ham toolkit. So if you don't have a ham toolkit after you pass your license, you should probably get one. And we should probably have additional training for hams that already have their license that haven't actually done this. Of course, we can make that a maybe a two-week course later on. So before you go on, study the technician questions. All right, so resistance. All materials impede the flow of electrons to some degree. This property is called resistance and is represented by the symbol R. So you see the letter R, that means that it's resisting. Resistance is futile. So resistance is measured in ohms, which are represented by the Greek letter omega. Resistance is measured in ohm meters. Materials in which electrons flow easily in response to an applied voltage are conductors. Metals such as copper are good conductors, and so is salt water. The human body conducts electricity as well. Materials that resist or prevent the flow of electrons are insulators, such as glass, ceramics, dry wood, paper, most plastics, and other nonmetals. George Ohm, a 19th century scientist, discovered the voltage, current, and resistance are proportional. Ohm's law states that current is directly proportional to voltage and inversely proportional to resistance. The more material resists the flow of electrons, the lower the current will be in response to voltage across the material. As an equation, you're going to want to know this. You're going to have to know it. I equals E divided by R. You will also see this written as I equals V divided by R. Okay, so what's I? Say that again. Loud enough so everybody can hear you.
Current.
I is current. What's V? What other letter can voltage be?
V.
Of E. So voltage can be V or E, and what's R?
Resistance.
Resistance. Of course, I'm a big Star Trek fan, so every time I hear that, I just want to say resistance is futile. So, with the V representing voltage, if you know any two, so if you know the I, the E, or if you know the two of the I, E, or R, you can figure out what the third one is, and we're about to look at that. The drawings in figure 3-4, they are convenient. So let's take a look at that. Okay. All right. Here's the pi. Now, P, we haven't looked at that yet, but I believe that stands for power. These simple diagrams will help you remember the Ohm's law. A and power, B, relationship. If you know any two of the quantities, if you know any of the two, you can figure out what the three are, okay? So let's kind of take a look down here. So have we caught up here with it? Okay,
yep.
Good. So we've got three diagrams here. In the first one, we're looking for E, okay? So E equals I times R equals 2 times 10 equals 20 volts. Okay, does everybody get that? So E, what is E?
Voltage.
Okay, so we're looking to find out how many volts. Okay, so voltage is I, which is, okay, times R. What's R? That's right. So If we look up here, we can see I equals 2 amps, okay? R equals 10, was that ohms? Anyway, okay, so 2 times 10 equals 20 volts. So two of these, so when you're looking for E, which is what? And so when you're looking for voltage, and this can be what other letter? B. So if you're, whenever you're looking for E or V, okay, you're going to be, it's going to be a multiplication of the other two. If you're looking for the other two, it's going to be a division problem, okay? So the only time you multiply is when you're looking for voltage.
Will?
Yes, yes. Yes, so E is voltage. Okay, so E equals I times R. Okay? And so if you look up here, you're going to want to know what I and R are. So I is 2 and R is 10. Okay? So you multiply the 2 times the 10 and that gives you 20. And voltage is always in volts. I'm sorry, Jen, you had something?
Yeah, scroll up to show the circle up there.
Yeah, let me see. There you go. Can you see that?
The easy way to remember this is if you have that circle, E over IR, whichever one you want to find, like if you don't know resistance, put your finger over the R and solve the other one. If you want to know the current, put your finger over the I. It just tells you what to multiply or divide by.
Okay. I can't put my finger, but I'll put my little cursor, so I and E. So remember, in E, it's always going to be multiplication of these two, right? So when we're trying to find E, it's going to be multiplication. If it's going to be I or P, it's always going to be division. Is that right? I believe.
Well, on the other one, if you want to find I, you cover it up, and it'll be P over divided by E.
Right, but if we're looking for voltage, that's going to be multiplication.
Right.
Okay. So
if you cover up the E, it shows I and R side by side, which means multiply. One over the other is one.
Said it like that before. Okay, I see what you're saying. So if they're right next to each other, it's going to automatically be multiplication. So if it's looking for E, then these two down here are being multiplied. Okay. Okay.
And the same thing will hold true with that other circle where when you're talking about power.
Okay. So
cover up the one you want to find and solve it.
Okay. So power. Okay. So we're going to multiply.
Yeah, we haven't gotten the power yet, so.
Gotcha. Okay. All right. So. All right. So now let's kind of go back down here for a second. In this equation, we are going to be. Oops, a little bit too far. Apologize, I forgot my mouse. Let's see if I can't get to that. Okay, so in this equation, we've got the volts and the resistance. And so what are we looking for in the second one? What's I? Anybody remember what I is? What?
Current.
Okay.
Current.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, so everybody's in agreement. All right, so what's E? What is E? What's I? What's R? What's E? What's V? What's I? What's R? Are you sure? Okay. So in this one, we're actually going to be looking for I, which is? Current. Okay. So current equals E over R. And what's E? And what's R? Okay. So let's find voltage, which is E. E is 12. So it's going to be 12 divided by R, which is resistance, so 6. So what's 12 divided by 6?
2.
So again, what's I? Okay, so, and we measure currents in what? Amps. So if the answer is going to be 2 amps. There you go.
Currents always measured in amps.
Currents measured in amps. There you go. So the very last one, we are going to be looking for R, which is resistance, right? And it's going to be E over I, or E divided by I, and E is what? What's V? What's E? There we go. And what's I? Okay. So E, or voltage, is going to be divided by I, which is? Okay, so E is going to be 8, so it's going to be 8 divided by 2, and what's, oh, I'm sorry, is that 6? So that's a 6. 6 divided by 2. And the answer is 3 what?
Ohms.
Yes, ohms. Okay.
This one
right over here. The third one right here. Okay. So we went from needing volts to current to resistance. Okay. Are we good with this? I would take this home and practice. This would be a good practice. Okay, so R is your resistance, right? Okay, so R is, that's what we're looking for. And the way to find it is you're going to go E or V, which is your voltage, over I, which is your current. So your E divided by your I. In this case, it's 6 divided by 2. Right, so they're always, when you sit to take your test, they're going to give you two of these. They're going to give you voltage and resistance, or current and resistance, or two, and then you're going to have to know where they all go. First of all, do I need to multiply? Well, the only time I need to multiply is if, and they may be tricky, and instead of an E, they may put a V here. Okay, so if this is an E or V, it's going to be multiplication. Okay, and if you're multiplying, it doesn't matter in which order the I or the R comes in. Okay, the current or the resistance, doesn't matter, because you're going to be multiplying. Now, when you're looking at the other two, right, if you're looking for current or resistance, it's going to matter, because it's always going to be volts over resistance, or volts over current, okay, or volts divided by resistance, or volts divided by current. So the way this looks is, and I'm going to ask Jim this question, it looks like regardless on the, when you're dividing, when you're looking for current or resistance, it looks like the voltage is always on top. You're going to be dividing it by the other one. Is that right, Jim?
It's like it shows the, with that little circle.
Okay. And you can, and we can come back up here and take, if it's easier for you to memorize this little circle, then do it. But it, now this has power instead of resistance up here.
So, yeah, we're getting ready to get into power, so.
Okay.
Is there ever a situation that the amps is going to come out to not a whole number? Is that always going to be a whole number?
No.
As far as the test goes, I don't think they get real tricky. I don't remember when I took, and I took two tests because I failed my first test. The second time I set for the test, well, I don't remember seeing any tricky questions as far as making the math hard. It's just remembering, you know, where to place the number. Because they don't give you a calculator. You get a pencil and a piece of paper, you know, to make notes and things of that nature. So, but
the big thing on the test as far as the calculations go is getting the decimal point in the right place. when you're converting from milli to nano or whatever.
Right.
And this section in the test has questions that cover that too.
Okay, so is everybody good? Can we move forward? Okay, here we go, moving on. Oh look, it's power, imagine that. Okay, power represented by the symbol P, thank you for using P and not Q or J, is measured in watts, which are abbreviated as W. Power is the rate at which electricity energy is used, okay? So how many watts does my computer, how many watts does my ham radio use? Watts is the rate at which the power is being consumed or used. Power is calculated as the product of voltage and current. Okay, everybody get that? Power is calculated as the product of voltage and current. An amount of power consumed is often referred to as the load that is applied to a circuit. As with Ohm's law, if you know any part of power, what's E or V? What's E or V? Volt, right? Voltage. What's I? It should be a C. Or current, okay. You can determine the missing quantity as follows. P, which is power, equals voltage times IE equals power. So 11 equals P. E because Ohm's law links voltage, current, and resistance. E and I, or voltage and current, can be replaced in the power equations with their equivalents. And this is, now if you look at this equation, it's going to look, you're going to look at that and go, because I'm looking at it now, I'm going, P equals times IP equals I times R in parentheses times I, so P equals 12XR. Okay, so Jim, you're probably much better at math than I am with this. You want to give this a whirl because this is a pain in the butt for me.
Okay, the same thing holds true. If you go back to the circles where it had E over IR.
Mm-hmm. Let me go back.
For power, you have P over IE.
Okay.
And so you cover up the one you want to find, and you either multiply or divide. Like if you want to find voltage, it's watts divided by amps.
Okay, so it's important that you understand, you know, not only voltage and current and resistance, but you should know what they're measured in, whether it's ohms or volts or amps. It's really important that you know that. So,
well, now, a lot of this that we're talking about now, this really, every homeowner should know some of this, because you have circuit breakers that are rated for so many amps, typically 15 or 20 per circuit. Well, how many amps is going through that circuit if you've got six 100 watt light bulbs?
That's a good question. Let's okay, so how many let's go back up. We can go back up to, nope, not too far.
Well, you haven't divided by 120, but you've got 600 watts.
I'm trying to find the okay, maybe it's a little further down. Okay, so explain to them how to work out that equation, Jim, if you wouldn't mind.
Okay, well, you've got six 100-watt light bulbs,
mm-hmm.
a total of 600 watts of power that you're using.
Okay.
So if you take that 600 watts and divide it by 120 volts, which is what your standard household is, that's how many amps you're pulling for those light bulbs.
Okay, so if I bring up my handy dandy calculator, so we're taking 200 watts.
600.
Oh, okay, yes. Okay, so 600 watts and we're dividing them by
120.
So 5. So we're, right. We're well within the 15
You're drawing 5 amps of current.
5 amps of the 15 amps that it's regulated for.
Right.
Okay.
But some of that stuff is used, I mean, even in household stuff, you use it if you're trying to see, well, am I going to overload a circuit or not? It's relatively easy to calculate.
Okay. So, let's move on. How much power is being used in a circuit when applied voltage is 12 volts and the current is 10 amps? All right, here we go. Everybody break out their scrap piece of paper. It's time to do some math. How many amps are flowing in a circuit when applied voltage is 12 volts and the load is 240 watts? So the power, the watts, remember power is it's that particular item is using 240 watts. And circuit applied voltage is 12 volts and the load is 240. So what we're looking for is amps. How many amps? Do we know how to solve that? Power equals E times I. So how many watts are we talking?
How many amps are you talking?
Or amps, I'm sorry. So is this a simple division? So is this going to be a multiplication or a division problem? What are we multiplying or are we dividing? So how much power is being used in a circuit when the applied voltage is 12 volts and the current is 10 amps? So how do we come to that 12 or multiplied by 10, right? Okay. Now back to our next question. How many amps are flowing in a circuit when the applied voltage is 12 volts and the load is 240 watts? So we're looking for amps. Okay. And congratulations, Sarah. You are now technically part of this training. And Mark, can you get in touch with Sarah M when you get a chance and see if she let her know I'll get back to her when we're done training, please. What is the voltage in a circuit? A 50-watt load draws 5 amps. This one I have a problem with. So we're looking for the voltage, which is E or V, in a circuit if a 50 watt load, that's the power, draws 5 amps. So E or V, which is your voltage, equals P, which is your power, divided by your I, equals 50 divided by 5, which is 10 volts. Okay. So the only way that you're going to get used to this, guys, is sit down and actually go through this. I remember when I did this, I literally spent hours sitting down and going through when do I multiply and when do I divide. That's really honestly what you're going to have to. That's how I did it. I just went through and I sat down and remembered that I had to divide this by this and multiply this by that.
If you can remember circles.
Or you can remember the circles. Well, it's not just the circles too, because if you power, you're going to, power is in watts. You have to know that's, why is it not volts? So not only do you need to know where in this formula what goes, but you need to know how their, you know, power is done in watts. You need to know that. So you're gonna have homework. Like I said, if you don't study for this, you're probably not gonna pass. I would study. Questions on any of this? It's just, you're gonna have to spend time. I had to. Math, science, and technical stuff like this is not me at all. And if you're kind of like me, you're gonna have to spend more time studying. I don't know an easier way to put it other than that. Yeah, the letters and the circles are always in the same place. So that's nice. So if you can remember that, that'll probably help. I know that this diagram here with the E over IRP, actually, it just kind of spells pi, which is kind of nice. If you can remember that I is current and E or V. Yeah, I just. Mm-hmm. The P turns into an R. Starts with an M. Mosu or Mouse. I don't know how you pronounce it. So Sarah, you again are part of this training. Congratulations. All right, so we went over power. Okay, so now we're getting ready to go into alternating current and direct current. Again, this wasn't a concept that was easy for me to grasp, only because I didn't have a very good grasp on electricity. So AC and DC electrical current takes different forms depending on the source that creates the voltage, making the electrons move. Okay, current that flows in one direction all the time is direct current, abbreviated as DC. Current that regularly reverses direction is alternating current, abbreviated as AC. So figure 636 shown above, just like current, a voltage has the same polarity, the same direction from positive to negative voltage all the time as DC voltage. A voltage that regularly reverses polarity is an AC voltage. Batteries and solar cells are sources of DC or direct current, voltage and current. So voltage and current, okay. Now you guys remember the difference between voltage and current. It's really important to understand that. Who can tell me the difference between voltage and current? Right. The electric, well, there you go, that's perfect. So voltage is the electric pressure, the force of the electrons as they move through the circuit. And then of course current is the how many electrons move through that circuit every second, okay? So household power is supplied by electrical utility in the form of AC voltage and current. Just as we discussed in the section on radio waves in chapter 2, a complete sequence of AC current flowing, stopping, reversing, and stopping again is one cycle. The number of cycles per second is the AC's current frequency as well. So just like radio waves has a frequency, so does electrical current. In fact, when you talk about a radio wave inside of a circuit or wire, it's an actual electrical current, if you can think of it that way. So as it's broad, so it goes through the wire up to your antenna, and then it's broadcast through the air. Okay, so, but it starts out as an electrical current. And it has a voltage and frequency. In fact, a radio signal in a cable wire is AC current. The frequency of a household AC voltage is 50 or 60 hertz. While radio signals used by amateurs have frequency of megahertz and gigahertz. Can anybody tell me how many hertz are in a megahertz? How many are in a gigahertz? There you go. So 1 billion hertz are in a megahertz. 1 million hertz are in a megahertz, 1 billion a gigahertz. Before you go on, study these technician exam questions. 3.2. components and units. Now we're getting into hardware, guys and gals. This is the actual physical components within your rig. So components and units. Electronic circuits are made from components and connections between them. Each component performs a discrete function, storing or dissipating energy, routing current, or amplifying a signal. In this chapter, you'll learn about the different types of common components and their functions. We begin by reviewing the way components and signals are measured. Basic components. The three most basic types of electronic components are resistors, capacitors, and inductors, also known as coils. These have their own units of measurement and have a different effect on voltage and current. The wires that are used to make connections to the component are called leads, pronounced leads, and have only small effects on the performance of the component. Resistors. Resistors have a certain resistance specified in ohms, kiloohms, or megaohms. The function of a resistor is to oppose the flow of electrical current, just as a valve in a water pipe restricts the flow through the pipe. Resistors, like valves, control the flow of current. Resistors, like valves, control the flow of current. The electrical current flowing through the resistor loses some of its energy as heat, so resistors also dissipate energy like an electrical brake. Okay, so these are just some of the different resistors that you can find in most rigs. Okay, capacitors. So we talked about resistors. Now we're going to talk about capacitors. So resistor is what? What's one thing that a resistor does inside your radio? Can anybody tell me? What's it? What can it? It's kind of like a valve, right? What does a resistor do? Yeah, it can limit current. It can dissipate heat. It's used to control current. So it's a resistor. It's resisting the current. It also dissipates energy. So that's what a resistor is. So now we're going to jump into capacitors. Capacitors store electrical energy in an electric field. Okay, that's different because now we're not talking about restricting flow, we're talking about storing electrical energy in an electrical field. And we're about to talk about another type of item that it also holds energy, but in a magnetic field. So you're going to have two different types of fields. You'll have electric fields and you have magnetic fields, but they both do the same thing. They hold energy. Okay, so between two conducting surfaces such as metal foil called electrodes separated by an insulating dielectric. Storing energy this way is called capacitance, and it is measured in farads. So when you store electrical energy in a capacitor with an electric field, whatever that amount of electricity is, you're going to measure it in farads. Capacitors used in radio circuits have values measured in picofarads, nanofarads, and microfarads. Gang, those are really, really, really small values versus mega, giga, and tera. They're on the other opposite end of all of that. So very, very, very small. As it stores and releases energy in a circuit, a capacitor smooths out the voltage changes. Because of the electrodes are separated, a capacitor cannot pass DC current. Okay, so you got a DC current that's coming in, and what would be something that would generate a DC current? Battery, perfect. Okay, so you've got a battery; it's not going to be able to make it through the capacitor. Okay, AC current, however, which comes from your utility company, however, can pass through a capacitor. In most capacitors, the electrodes and dielectric are sealed inside a protective coating shown below. Inductors store energy in magnetic fields. So capacitors have electric stored through an electric field, and inductors, they're the exact same thing. They do the exact same thing. They just do it in a different way. They use a magnetic field to capture energy. Okay, capacitors electric, inductors magnetic. You're going to need to know that. I know that was on the test. So stores energy in the magnetic field created by a current flowing through a wire. This is called inductance, which is different than capacitance. it's the same thing. It's just called two different things depending on if you're talking about capacitors or you're talking about inductors. Okay. So inductors have values measured in nanohenries, microhenries, and millihenries, and just plain old henry. So question about capacitors or inductors, what they do, how they store things, how they're being measured. Any questions on this? This stuff was on my exam. I remember seeing them. Oh yeah, it's funny now. It sucked at the time.
One thing to remember, and what you mentioned, is capacitors will block direct current. They will pass AC current. Inductors are just the opposite. They will pass DC current as if they weren't even there, and they will block or resist AC current.
I didn't know that.
So, yeah, and the two of them, the primary uses outside of controlling voltage in an amateur radio is to filter signals. If you want to filter the DC out just to get the AC, which is what you want to send to the antenna, then what do you use? You use capacitors.
Okay.
Because it'll let the AC go through. If you want to block alternating current and just have DC, which is what you want for your power supply, you want nice, clean power, then you use an inductor to block the AC. So they're used for other things, but one of the main things they're used for is for filtering within the radio.
Okay, so either electricity or frequency.
Well, you're either blocking direct current or alternating current.
Gotcha.
You're filtering one or the other out.
Awesome. Okay.
In fact, you may be filtering a certain frequency of alternating current even.
Okay.
By mixing and matching, they get very specific as what they're filtering. But okay. That's a primary use for them.
Awesome. Okay, I think now would be a great time for a break. I'm going to go ahead and pause our training. So everybody go ahead and take a 5-minute break. We'll see you back in 5. Okay, I hope everyone enjoyed your time off and your little break session here. But we are really excited to get back talking about inductors and power and all kinds of good stuff. So the photograph above shows styles of capacitors. Now, can anybody tell me what capacitors do? They store electrical charges by using an electrical field. That's awesome. And so what does an inductor do? There we go. So inductors do the same thing as capacitors, right? They store energy, but they use different types of field, right? So which one uses a magnetic field to store energy? An inductor. Okay, and what does a capacitor use to store energy? Electric field. Outstanding. Some of you guys are going to get big smiley faces on your report cards. Okay, and so what does a resistor do? No, they marry Will because they can't handle my capacitor. That's why. So we were joking earlier that my wife is a resistor, and that's true. But she could not resist my flux capacitor, and now we're married. So now that we know what resistors are. Well, that was kind of late, but we'll take it. At any rate, so now that we know what resistors, capacitors, and resistors do, we're going to go ahead and move on. So as it stores and releases energy in a circuit, an inductor smooths out current changes. Inductors are made from wire wound in a coil, sometimes around a core of magnetic material that concentrates the magnetic energy. For direct current, DC currents, an inductor appears to be a short circuit, but it resists the flow of AC current. And Jim talked about that just a minute ago, and let's kind of go back up because that's really important to understand. So capacitors, what can't flow through a capacitor? What type of current?
DC.
Direct current. Okay, AC current, however, can pass right through a capacitor. Now, if we're talking about an inductor, it's just the opposite. AC current can't pass through. Okay. And so Jim was talking earlier about, Jim, do you want to go, while, now that we're recording, you want to go and touch on that real quick so everybody that didn't make the training can understand that?
What, about the capacitance and inductance?
Right, the capacitance and inductance inside your radio. Why? What are they used for?
Yeah, the capacitors are used to filter out direct current. So inside the radio, when it develops your signal to go out to the your antenna, it has a mixture of direct and alternating current. So use a capacitor to block the direct current and just let the alternating current through to go out to your antenna.
Awesome.
Inductors block alternating current. So like on your power supply that provides your 12 volt DC current, to filter out any noise on it, they use an inductor which would block any AC components. They use the combination of those two to filter out all sorts of stuff. You can filter out certain parts of a alternating current and things by using them in combination. They're used primarily for filtering, either filtering AC or filtering DC.
Awesome. Thank you very much for breaking that down for everybody. If you look on your screen, you'll notice that we've got another cheat sheet here. And most of these measurements were created or named after their creator. Okay, so Dana is now officially back. If somebody wants to try to grab her, please. So amps was developed by Andre Marie Ampere. Okay. Now, does anybody remember what a coulomb is? It's electrical charge. And how many amps makes up a coulomb? 250. Was it billion? Okay. So farads, henries, hertz, ohms, watts, volts. It's important that you know the differences because you're going to need to know them. That's just more homework. I know you guys are loving me. So that's what I'm here for. Okay, here are two types of inductors. On the top are air core inductors. Those on the bottom use a magnetic material to concentrate the stored energy and increase inductance. At the lower right is an inductor wound on a toroid core. I have no idea what that is. So moving on to something else that I'm not familiar with. All three types of basic components are also available as adjustable or variable models. A variable resistor is also called a potentiometer, or POT pot, because it is frequently used to adjust voltage or potential, such as for a volume control. A variable capacitor and inductors are used to time radio circuits for a variety of purposes, and that's in Figure 3.10. Transformers. I was a big fan of transformers when I was a kid. Come to find out, they're not really what I thought. So transformers are made from two or more inductors. And what do inductors do? Anybody? They store energy, right? Or control energy.
Yeah.
So transformers are made from two or more of these inductors that share their stored energy. So if a transformer is literally two different inductors that are sharing the energy. So the more inductors you have, the more energy that they can store. This allows energy to be transformed from one inductor to another while changing the combination of voltage and current. For example, a transformer is used to transfer energy from a home's 120 volt AC outlet to a lower voltage for use in electronic equipment. Aha! How awesome is that? That's something kind of cute to know. Before you go on, study these technician exam questions for the questions all included, blah, blah, blah. So that's a transformer. So what's a transformer? No, it is not Optimus Prime.
One or more inductors.
One or more inductors, right, that share the energy. Okay, so one of the uses of a transformer is to decrease the amount of power that's going to be used by a device. Okay, so now let's go down to reactance and impedance. Again, we're talking about my wife. In a reason, I hope she never listens to this. Yeah, I know. In a resistor, AC voltages, does that really work? In a resistor, AC voltages, or voltage, and currents are exactly in step or in phase. As voltage increases, so does current and vice versa. In capacitors and inductors, the relationship between AC voltage and current, and it's important that you understand the difference between, again, voltage is what? Electrical pressure, and what is current? Electrical flow, right. The number of electrons that flow through the circuit every second. So voltage is pushing the current. Okay, so in capacitors and inductors, the relationship between AC alternating current voltage, or AC voltage and current, is altered. All right, so they're not in phase. Does everybody understand that? Hopefully. All right. So in capacitors and inductors, the relationship between AC voltage and current is altered so that there is an offset in time between changes in one and changes in the other as energy is stored and then released. That means voltage and current have a phase difference. They're no longer in phase. In a capacitor, in a capacitor, the changes in current are a little ahead of or lead voltage changes. In a capacitor, the changes in current are a little ahead of or lead voltage. In a capacitor, the changes in current are a little ahead of or lead voltage changes because the capacitor smoothing action works against the changes in voltage, not current. Everybody get that? The capacitor smoothing action, the capacitor attacks or changes the value of voltage. Okay, so that's important. In an inductor, changes in the AC current lag a little behind changes in voltage because the inductor resists changes in current. I would know that. Okay, so depending on if you're talking about a capacitor or an inductor, one has a change on voltage, the other has a change on resistance or voltage. So the results is in opposition to AC current flow called reactance. The result is in opposition to AC current flow called reactance, represented by the capital letter X. I don't know why X, why wouldn't it be like R X or something? No. At any rate, reactance is measured in ohms, as is resistance. Reactance from a capacitor is called capacitive resistance, and from an inductor, inductive resistance. You should not miss that question on the exam, okay? Reactance is measured in ohms. Reactance from a capacitor is called capacitive reactance. An inductor is inductive reactance. You should not miss that question. The value of a component's reactance depends on the amount of capacitance or inductance and the frequency of the AC current. The combination of... Do you have a question? No? Okay, moving on. The value of a component's reactance... Let me know when you're good. Got it? Okay, good. The frequency at which resonance occurs is resonant frequency. This brings the AC current and voltage exactly back in step. Yeah, we're back before that too. So where did I leave off? The combination of resistance and reactance is called impedance. okay, represented by the capital letter Z, and is also measured in ohms. Radio circuits almost always, get in touch with Dana, please. In a circuit with both the effect of capacitance and inductive resistance on an AC current is different because the opposite offset in time between voltage and current. In a circuit with both capacitive and inductive reactance, at some frequency, the two types of reactance will be equal and cancel each other out. This brings the AC current and voltage back in step with each other, a condition called resonance. The frequency at which resonance occurs is the resonant frequency. Okay, so we're talking about breaking up. Bear with me. So we need to we should probably recap this, because reactance, impedance, resonance, this is a lot to take in. This is something that you're gonna have to take home and study, but I want to make sure that everybody understands this. So you have two different devices that's at work here. Capacitor, and what's the other one? And what? A capacitor and a... So a capacitor does... A capacitor affects what? Voltage, right? So a capacitor works against voltage. And so what does an inductor do? So a capacitor works against voltage, and then an inductor works against, okay. So it's in, when you get time, go back over this paragraph and read this again. Make sure that you understand what they work on, and understand that as the current and the voltage moves through a circuit, they're in phase. Okay, the combination of resistance and reactance is called impedance. Okay, that's where both the current and the voltage is being reduced, and depending on which item is doing the reducing depends on what they're going to call it. So I would go back, reread this, make sure that you completely understand it, because it's really, really important. And then understanding that they both start out the same, equal. Okay, so the voltage, sorry, brain freeze. So the voltage and the current start out equal, they're in phase. And as they're acted on by the capacitor inductor, one of them is going to be reduced. But you look at the end result, they both come back in phase, and when that happens, that's your resonant frequency. That's when both your current and your voltage are back the same again, and that's called resonance. And then that frequency is your resonant frequency. So let's go and move on. And I know this chapter is tough. This is one of the more challenging, unless you have a background in this, in which case this is icing on your cake. So, question?
Keep in mind, it's a multiple choice test.
Right.
So when you take the question, look at the question. If you can eliminate two of them, you stand a 50% chance of getting the other one. And so it's not where you have to fill in the blank. You have to be able to recognize the terms. You don't have to know how to write them down, in other words. So the test is not as hard as it might seem when you're trying to learn this stuff.
That is true. That is true. So you will have a multiple guess test, and process of elimination will be your friend. It was mine.
So this is pretty simple. I mean, I'm kind of lost right now, because and electronics are not my forte, so I should be able to look at this manual again once I can get a chance to get to it, and it should make more sense, because right now it seems like it's kind of Greek.
Yeah, you're coming in.
Yeah, Dana, if you have any problems understanding it, let me know separately offline, and I can get with you, and we can go over it again.
Awesome. Cool.
Yeah, Sarah, this is week two. So we went over chapters 1 and 2 last week. That video is rocking and rolling, so you can go and check that out on I think I've posted the link, and I'll repost it once I get this video taken care of, so you can look at week 1 and 2 and be caught up. And then of course, you know, Jim and I will be available to any help.
Okay, I appreciate it. Well,
okay, so moving on to diodes, transistors, and integrated circuits. This is going to be a good time. So everybody knows what resistors, capacitors, and inductors generally treat all values and polarities of voltage, current the same. There are other types of components whose response depends on the polarity and value of voltage and current. These are usually conducted from a semiconductor material. Some materials don't conduct electricity quite as well as metallic conductor, nor are they good insulators. These materials are called semiconductors, which means they aren't really good at either of the two. They're kind of in the middle. Some semiconductors, such as silicone, have a useful property that adding small amounts of certain impurities called doping changes their ability to conduct current. The impurities create N-type or P-type materials depending on the chemical properties of the impurity. When N and P-type materials are placed in contact with each other, the result is a P-N junction that conducts better in one direction than the other. This and other properties are used to create many useful electronic components, generally referred to as semiconductors. So now everybody knows what a semiconductor is, right? Everybody should be very excited about that. 3.11 shows several types of semiconductor components. Semiconductor that only allows current flow in one direction is called a diode. Okay, so a semiconductor that only allows current flow in one direction is called a diode. Heavy-duty diodes that can withstand large voltages and currents are called rectifiers. Again, sounds like my wife. If an AC voltage is applied to a diode, the result is a unidirectional pulsing DC current, because current is blocked when the voltage tries to push electrons in the wrong direction. The diode has two electrodes, an anode and a cathode. Do I need to go back over that again? Everybody, is this crystal clear like mud, right? A semiconductor.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so a semiconductor that only allows current flow in one direction is called a diode. I don't know why they wouldn't call it a monode. That one makes more sense to me, but I didn't write the book. Heavy-duty diodes that can withstand large voltage currents are called rectifiers. If an AC voltage is applied to a diode, the result is a unidirectional pulsing DC current, because current is blocked when the voltage tries to push electrons in the wrong direction. I have a tough time with that particular sentence, but as long as you understand the basic definition, if the question is a semiconductor that only allows current to flow in one direction is called a rectifier, B anode, C cathode, or D diode, what are y'all gonna pick? D diode. That's what Jim was referring to earlier. As long as you can kind of pick these things out and kind of recognize them for that split second to argue left, because that's what it was like for me. Because this part, like I said, this chapter was very challenging for me. Okay, but that's going to be kind of like the questions. Yes, sir.
Quick, if you remember the waveform of an alternating current, you had the line in the center, which was a zero reference. We'll chop off either the bottom or the top of that. What's left is that what they call pulsating DC. It just chops, just where that zero line is, it just cuts off the bottom or the top, depending on which direction it's going through the diode.
Okay. Okay, so now everyone's heard the term LED, right? That's a light emitting diode. Gives off light when current flows through it. The material from which the LED is made determines the color of light emitted. LEDs are most often used as a visual indicator. Okay, so a diode is what? Who can tell me what a diode is? Anybody? That's right. Yeah. So that's good. So remember one direction, not the band, but the direction in which the electricity, and then a light emitting diode is simply a light. It's used for as indicator light. So when the current flows through the LED, it illuminates to let you know that, well, there's current that's flowing through it. The materials from which the LED is made determines the color of the LEDs are most often used as visual indicators, requiring less power. LEDs are often used instead of incandescent indicator lamps. Transistors, which is different than transformers. Transistors are components made from patterns of N and P type materials. The patterns from structures that allow the transistor to use small voltages and currents to control larger ones. So, the transistor's electrodes are contacts made to a certain piece of the pattern. With the approximate external circuits of a source of power, transistors can amplify or switch voltages and currents. Using small signals to control larger signals is called gain. I call something else, but okay, that works for me. There are two common types of transistors. Bipolar junction transistors, or BJTs, and field effect transistors. The BJT is made from three alternating layers of N and P-type material. The electrodes are called the base emitter and collector. There are two types of BJT, NPN and PNP, referring to the arrangement of the layers. The FET is constructed as a conducting path of channels of N or P-type material. The ends of the channel from the source and drain electrodes, the gate electrode, is used to control current flow from the channel. Okay, so as we read through this, I know that, you know, we've been going at this for, you know, a while now. Keep in mind, take these notes, and I've kind of highlighted the really important parts. Transistors, what's a transistor? What's a bipolar junction transistor? Transistor, gate electrode, what is it, what does it do, integrated circuit. An integrated circuit, IC or chip, is made of many components connected together as a useful circuit and packaged as a single component. IC or integrated circuits range from very simple circuits consisting of a few diodes all the way to complex microprocessors or signal processing chips with many thousands of components. Before you go on, study these technician exam questions. That's a good idea. Also, if you go through, what helped me also, other than sitting and banging my head against the wall, go through this test. The test questions are very, very similar or identical to what's actually on the test. So if you go through them, and what I did is I just like flashcards. I went through, you know, the questions, and I went to the answer, and after a while, they just started coming to me. It'll help. So, protective components. Protective components such as those in Figure 312 are used to prevent equipment damage or safety hazards such as fire or electrical shock due to equipment malfunction. They're designed to have little or no effect on circuit behavior until the dangerous condition occurs. It's important to understand the different types of protective components and use them correctly. There are fuses and circuit breakers. Fuses. Fuses interrupt current overloads by melting a short length of metal. When the metal melts or blows, the current path is broken and power is removed from the circuit supplied by the fuse. Fuses cannot be reused. Fuses are rated by the maximum current that they carry without blowing. Slow blow fuses can withstand temporary overloads but will still blow if the overload is sustained. Circuit breakers. By the way, you should never, everybody here should never have fuses in their house. They should all be gone now. Circuit, or your insurance agent will have a cow. Circuit breakers act like fuses by tripping when current overloads occur. This is what most of us have in our homes today. Tripping opens or breaks the circuit. Unlike fuses, circuit breakers can be reset once the current overload is removed, closing the circuit and allowing current to flow again. Used in AC power wiring, a ground fault circuit interrupter, GFCI. You love acronyms and initialisms. So a GFCI, or a ground fault circuit interrupter, circuit breaker shown in Figure 313, trips if an imbalance is sensed in the current carried by the hot and neutral conductors. And now Adam Miller is now part of our training. Congratulations, I know. Current imbalances indicated presence of an... Okay, so when replacing a fuse or circuit breaker, be sure to use the same model and current rating to avoid creating a safety hazard. Using a larger value, even temporarily, could allow... That's really bad. That's a good point. So if you have... Well, of course, you shouldn't have a fuse, but let's say you have a 15-amp fuse and it blows, don't replace it with a 25. That's bad. Okay, surge protectors. So fuses, circuit breakers, the ground fault circuit interrupter. Well, fuses, circuit breakers, and surge protectors are, you know, most people have a pretty good understanding of what they are. Lightning arresters, I love these terms, have a similar function but are designed to handle the much higher voltages. I still don't think that's a real word. And currents of a lightning strike. Okay. Everybody good on this part here? This is pretty common, I would think.
Lightning arresters, when you're talking about radios, will not handle a direct strike in 99% of the cases. They will handle what's called induced voltages from a near strike. In other words, if you have lightning strike, you know, 200 yards from you, a piece of wire, it's going to develop voltage in it. And the lightning arrester will take care of that. A direct strike is just going to wipe out an antenna completely.
Okay.
So lightning arrester, it helps close calls, but not a direct hit.
Gotcha. So
a lot of people think that, well, I've got a lightning arrester, it's going to protect me. No. It helps, but it's not a direct hit.
Well, let's take a look at circuit gatekeeper switches and relays. That sounds awesome. Okay. And guys, a lot of this is really, really dry, and I appreciate your patience. Okay. So circuit gatekeeper switches and relays are simple components that control current through a circuit by connecting and disconnecting the paths current can flow. Both can interrupt current, called opening a circuit, or allow it to flow, called closing a circuit. Show 314 shows different types of switching, blah blah blah. Okay, so circuit gatekeepers, switches, and relays. So they're opening and closing circuits, allowing electricity to flow. Switches and relays are described by their number of poles and the number of throws. Oh, I remember this. Pole, okay. So each pole controls the path of one current. Okay. For example, a single pole switch controls a single current flow, and a double pole switch controls two separate currents. Pretty simple. Single pole, one current, double pole, two currents. Each throw refers to a different path for the current. So the throw is a path. A double throw switch can route current through either of two paths, while single throw switch can only open and close a single path. The combination of poles and throws describe the switch. For example, I want to make sure that I understand this right, Jim. So each switch has a throw and a pole, or a double pole or double throw, right?
Yeah. If you think of the poles as wires going into and out of a switch,
okay,
a single pole, single throw, just turns it off and on. A single pole, double throw, have it on to one output, or you can have it on to a different wire output. You've got two different outputs out of that switch.
Okay, so what would be the practical application of a double pole switch?
A double pole, double throw?
Right.
That's basically where you have two circuits you're going to connect or disconnect at the same time.
Okay. Okay, I was just trying to visualize in my head, you know, the practical application. So you've got a switch, it's got a double throw, double pole, and so you've got two wires coming into the switch, and you've got a total of four options.
Going out.
Okay, so you've got two wires coming in, four wires going out, and that switch can, you know, move those two to either of the other two, right? Am I understanding?
Right. okay. in pairs to normally.
Okay.
A good example of a single pole double throw, it's like an antenna switch. You've got two antennas you want to hook to your radio. You've got a switch. You can switch one antenna in or you can switch the other antenna in.
Okay, and that's a single pole double throw.
Right.
Okay. All right, so one wire in, two wires going out, and then the switch switches back and forth between the two.
Right. And now some of them also have a what's called a neutral position where the same thing as turning it off.
Okay. Okay. Hey, does everybody get that, what we just talked about? Is that crystal clear mud stuff again? Oh, okay. Okay, so one of the students here wants to kind of wants you to elaborate on that a little bit, Jim. So single pole, well, maybe it's best to explain to them what a pole and what a throw is within a switch.
Okay, if you think of a pole as a piece of wire that's conducting electricity. So a single pole switch has one wire in and one wire out.
And that's usually just to turn that on and off, to break that circuit, right?
Yeah, single pole, single throw.
Okay.
That's what your light switch on your wall is.
Okay. So
you flip it on or you flip it off.
Okay. So you've got a light switch. You turn it on, you open the circuit, you turn it off, you close the circuit. Single pole, single throw. Now, you've got...
A single pole, double throw is you have one wire coming in, you have two going out. And you can connect to either wire. That's like if you have, the way I think of it is single pole, triple throw is a three-way light switch on a lamp.
Right, so you turn it once, it brightens, turn it twice, it brightens it even more, you turn it a third time, and it's super bright. Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah, what it does is one position lights up one wire going out, position two lights up the second wire going out, position three connects both of them together and lights both of them.
Okay.
So you have two filaments in that bulb.
Okay. And then you have a double pole, double throw, which is two wires coming in, four wires going out.
Right.
Okay. Okay, so, all right, so those are poles and throws and all kinds of good stuff. So let's move.
There was mud.
Well, I've got good news. We're almost done. So if I remember correctly. So looking at schematics and component symbols. And if you're like me and you don't have any hair, get some because you're going to need it to pull out. So if you're familiar with schematics and component symbols, then you're good. If not, again, it's something that you're just going to have to commit to memory. If a circuit contains more than two or three components, trying to describe it clearly in words becomes very difficult. To describe complicated circuits, engineers have developed a schematic diagram, or simply schematic. Schematics create a visual description of a circuit by using standardized representations of electrical components called circuit symbols. Figure 315, blah, blah, blah. So don't worry that you aren't familiar with all of them. Look for, and Chris Collins is now in the training. Okay, so look for and identify the circuit symbols for resistor, capacitor, inductor, diode, and transistor. Well-grounded symbols, figure 314, includes the different symbols for grounds, which can be confusing. Remember for section 3.1 that ground meant a reference voltage of the Earth's surface. The middle ground symbol in figure 315 represents a connection directly to the earth. Not all circuits require such a reference voltage. For some equipment, the reference voltage is obtained by connecting the metal enclosure or chassis in the left-hand ground symbol. The chassis may or may not have its own connection to an earth ground. Within a piece of equipment, a triangular ground symbol on the bottom left generally indicates a connection for current to flow back to the power supply. This is usually referred to as a circuit common or just common. If an A or D is added to the triangle, the current has digital computing components such as microprocessors, as well as circuits and handle analog signals. By keeping the return connection to the power supply separate for each type of circuitry, the analog signals are kept free of noise from the digital circuits. Let's see if we've got a diagram we can look at. Look at that! That's amazing. Okay, so now I'm going to see if I can...
Now, folks, this diagram is coming up here is one you want to pretty well learn, because there will be questions on quite a few of the symbols on here.
Yeah, so, and then he's right. I think I got at least two questions on this. So, now it's difficult to see on the board and the computer screen here, but you can find these online. If you go to Google, if you don't have the book, okay, go to Google and type in schematic symbols using circuit diagrams, and then you can have a copy of this. But you're gonna want to know these. Again, if you don't study, you will not pass the exam. Just like I did.
Now, on the transistor diagrams, you got six of them there. Basically, if you know that the transistor is a circle with a line with an arrow, it's got three lines in it, and one of them has an arrow, that will get you through it. You don't have to memorize the different types of transistors that much. Same thing on diodes. You know, there's different types of diodes. In general, you might run into one where they ask you, about a Zener diode, for sure. But here again, multiple choice is your friend. Some of it relates. If there's a coil, you know it's some type of inductor or transformer. So it's not as bad as what that figure looks like.
Right. Now, once you move on to, general and extra, you may need to be more familiar with this.
Yeah, general, not so much. Extra, unless you're willing to go back to college and learn some math, forget the extra.
Gotcha. Okay, then I'm forgetting the extra. All right, so now we're just talking about the tech license, so moving right along. Figure 316 shows the schematic for simple transistor circuits. The schematics are also used for technician exam. Each component is assigned a unique designator. Yeah, just in short, know those. Or let's go back here and take a look. So transistors, they all have the same type of unique characteristics, a circle and an arrow, okay, in almost all of them. Resistors, you got the squiggly line. Well, this one's not, but he's right. A lot of the capacitors, inductors, and transistors, they all have very, very similar characteristics. Know those characteristics, so when it comes up, if they show a symbol of a circle with an arrow through it, you know for sure it's not a resistor. It's certainly not a capacitor. It's not an inductor. I mean, there's no inductor, capacitor, or resistor that looks like a circle. Okay. So process of elimination will be huge, just like the big arrows or the little wave-like thingies, the little squiggly line. Each of those has a distinct feature about them that if you commit to memory, it'll make it easier for you.
Will?
Yes.
Yeah, one thing is if you see a symbol, like the resistor symbol or a capacitor symbol, uh-huh, and it's got a line through it.
Yes.
With an arrow, that means it's a variable. In other words, the value of that can vary depending on how you tune it. And that's true of resistors, it's true of transformers, inductors, and capacitors.
That's huge. Okay, I didn't even pick up on that. So variable, if it's got a line through it, it's a variable.
Now, if you look on your next diagram at the bottom where it has a diagram of an antenna tuner, it shows a coil with an arrow coming up out and coming in with an arrow. That indicates that it's variable.
Okay. Alrighty. Well, I know everybody is probably brain dead about now.
Yeah, and there will be questions about whether it's variable or not.
Okay, so... So here's a little schematic for you.
The bottom one there, C, the bottom inductor is a variable inductor because of the line with the arrowhead on it.
Gotcha.
Those two capacitors are also variable. The same reason.
Jim, I'm glad we got you on with this. Take a moment to study this schematic. Input also designated J1, J inductant, okay. Just know those. Types of radios and radio circuits. In chapter 2, you learned about some of the terms that describe the functions of a radio signal used for communication. Frequency, phase, modulation, bandwidth, sidebands, and so forth. In this section, we'll introduce some of the circuits that make those functions happen. The block diagrams that describe simple radios show how successive circuits called stages are arranged to construct basic radio transmitters and receivers. Transmit-receive switches in the early days of radio amateur used separate transmitters and receivers. A switch was used to connect an antenna to either the transmitter or receiver. As you might imagine, the circuit was called a transmit-receive switch, or just TR switch. The TR switch is still present in today's transceivers as an initial circuit. Yes.
Well, that's an internal circuit. It's inside the radio.
Yeah, I know. I was corrected. Okay, so you got your oscillator, your driver, your telegraph key, and power amplifier. Do you want to kind of cover this real quick, Jim, what they're trying to get across here?
They're just showing. Now, this is a simple Morse code radio, okay? And so you have an oscillator which produces a tone, if you will. The driver, which amplifies it to the point where you can use it. And then it goes through the telegraph key, which turns it off and on, and then through the final power amplifier, which actually sends it out on the antenna.
That's Morse code, folks, in really, really simple direct terms. Okay, oscillators and amplifiers. An oscillator produces a steady signal at one frequency. Oscillators are used in both receivers and transmitters to determine the operating frequency. In a transmitter, the output signal from an oscillator is modulated and amplified before actually being amplified to before applied to an antenna. The output signal from an oscillator is not strong enough for reliable communication over long distances. An amplifier circuit called a driver allows the oscillator to operate continuously at lower power so that its frequency remains stable. The output of the driver is then applied to the power amplifier, which has an output strong enough for reliable communications with other stations. In order to turn the output signal on and off as Morse code, the driver and power amplifier stages are keyed, switched on and off by a telegraph key. Now, filters, I think most of us have an idea what filters are, but let's go through this. Filters are circuits that perform very important functions in radio. Just like a filter you might use to remove dust or impurities from an air or water, radio filters are circuits that reject unwanted signals. A passive filter is made, and I remember this question. This question will definitely be on your test, or it's at least in the bank of questions. A passive filter is made from resistors, inductors, and capacitors. Tuned circuits made of inductors and capacitors are common examples of passive filters. Electronic circuits contained amplifiers can also act as filters and are called active filters. And I don't remember the exact way they worded it, but it was definitely on passive and active filters. Reducing a signal strength is called attenuation. A filter circuit rejects the unwanted signal at its input by attenuating them. The filter passes the desired signal onto the output with little or no attenuation. The name of a filter describes how it acts on signals of different frequencies. Figure 318 shows a filter in action called the filter response graph. And we're going to go take a look at that now. The name of a filter describes how it acts on a signal of different frequency. Okay, a filter that attenuates signals below a specified cutoff frequency is a high-pass filter. If the filter removes signals above the cutoff frequency, it's called a low-pass filter. And I don't know how they came to name those, but that's the name.
Think of it this way. the name of it has to do with what gets through the filter, not what's blocked.
Okay.
It seems backwards, but that's why it's they named them.
So
a high pass filter lets the high stuff through and blocks the low. A low pass lets the low through and blocks the path.
Gotcha. Okay. So low pass, high pass filters. Band pass filters reject signals outside the frequency band between the upper and lower cutoff frequencies. They act like low pass filter above an upper cutoff frequency and a high pass filter below the low cutoff frequency. A notch or band reject filter is the opposite of a band pass filter. A band of frequencies is attenuated while all others pass. Band pass and notch filters are called wide or narrow depending on whether the frequency range of interest is large or small. Filters are used in receivers to help reject unwanted signals. They also reduce spurious signals from transmitters and might cause interference. Filters can also be used to remove noise or prevent transmitted signals from interfering with non-radio equipment. Okay, and I promise we're almost done, gang. Modulators, the process of combining data or voice signals with an RF signal is modulation, as learned earlier. A circuit that performs the modulation function is therefore called a modulator. So I won't beat this to death, but we were talking about inputting voice or other data into a radio wave. It's called modulation. So the circuit that does the modulate, that puts that into the radio signal, is called a modulator. The result is an RF signal that can be communicated by radio. A demodulator circuit extracts the information a modulated signal. A modulator can be as simple as an on-off switch, like a telegraph key, or it can be very complex in the case of a high-speed data transmission. You can learn more about this in the ARM mixers. So modulators, demodulators. Modulators puts the information into the radio signal. Demodulator circuit takes the information out of the radio signal. Mixers. A mixer is closely related to a modulator. Both types of circuits combine signals with the intent of producing an output signal with a different frequency. The mixer, however, is designed to combine two RF signals and shift one of them to a third frequency. It does not combine an RF signal with a data or voice signal like a modulator does. Mixers. Okay, Don, you're part of the training. The circuit should not be confused with an audio mixer. Okay, before you go on, study these technician exams. Here's an easy one. We're going to talk about receivers for a minute. If we include mobile phones, the most widely used type of receiver today is called a direct conversion receiver. Direct conversion receivers use mixers to convert a modulated signal directly back to speech or data. If the modulating signal is digital data, the output of the mixer is converted back to data using digital signal processing techniques, or DSP. Software-defined radio, or SDR, receivers convert the incoming RF signal directly to digital data, and microprocessor performs all functions using the software. I don't even know if I have it in me to pronounce this. The super heterodyne intermediate frequency, which I think is just mean for someone to do that, where unwanted signals are rejected by filters after amplification and filtering at the IF. The signal is then demodulated. Techniques are used also, construct transmitter. Transmitter C. Essentially, the process of mix, filter, amplify, demodulate is run in reverse to create a transmitter. This is just how many modern transceivers are constructed, using clever switches schemes to reuse many of the same circuits on both receive and transmit. Selectivity and sensitivity. This is kind of important for getting clear signals, guys. Receivers are compared on the basis of two primary characteristics, sensitivity and selectivity. A receiver's sensitivity determines the ability to detect signals. Higher sensitivity means the receiver can detect weaker signals. Sensitivity is specified as a minimum detectable signal level, usually in microvolts. If a receiver is not sensitive enough, a preamplifier or preamp can be used. The preamp is connected between the antenna and receiver. Selectivity is the ability to receive to disseminate between different signals, retrieving only the information from the desired signal in the presence of the unwanted signals. High selectivity means that a receiver can operate properly even in the presence of strong signals or nearby frequencies. Receivers use filters to reject the unwanted signals. Transverters. The super heterodyne technique of shifting signal frequencies can also be applied to equipment level to convert an entire transceiver to operate on a band other than it was designed for. Instead of a mixer, a piece of equipment called a transverter is used. Low power transmitter output signals on one band are shifted to the new output frequency where they are amplified for transmission. A receiving converter, basically a mixer, shifts incoming signals to the desired bands band where they are received as regular signals by the transceiver. Transverters are used by hams to allow one main transceiver to be used on one or more new bands. For example, the new transceivers available for CW and SSB operation on 222 megahertz. A transverter is used to convert a 222 megahertz signal to and from a 28 megahertz band besides on all HF gear. Before you go on, study these technician questions. Yes, please do. And that is the end of chapter 3. Everybody clap. Yes.